When I started working for the International Wool Textile Organization in 2011, one of the first things that I was confronted with was the made-by environmental benchmarking tool for fibers. Here I was thinking that I had just signed up to a very sustainable industry, yet made-by made it very clear that actually the opposite was true. At the same time, I felt, and maybe you feel the same, that the sustainability index is kind of counterintuitive because wool is a natural, renewable, biodegradable fiber. How can it be that bad for our planet? So one of my first tasks back then at the WTO was to find out why was wool ranking in such a negative way, and of course also what would be the opportunities to get wool out of this bad rating. So welcome to today's session on wool behind the figures, and I will talk to you about what is behind that wool rates in such a negative way, and also what are the real questions we need to ask ourselves in order to assess the true environmental rating of our textile fibers. Before we dive in, just a little bit of a recap. The environmental benchmarking tools such as made-by, the IG index, and also the European product footprint all rely on life cycle assessment data, in short LCA data. And the International Standards Organization actually defines LCA as a technique used to assess the environmental impacts of products, processes, and services. And as the name LCA, or life cycle assessment, already kind of describes, it includes all stages of a product's life. And for wool, that means it starts on farm with gathering the raw material, the processing, the distribution, the use, and the end of life stage. And one more thing that is really important when we talk about LCA to remember is that actually LCA is quite a young area of research, and there's lots of development going on. Best practices are still being agreed upon, and we are constantly learning more in this space. And in fact, also the wool industry has been actively contributing to research on wool LCA, and this is done through a wool LCA technical advisory group. It was founded 7 years ago, and it is made up of internationally recognized LCA experts. And the goal of this group is first to identify the best practices for wool LCA and then also to deliver accurate LCA data to the textile industry. And the reason for that is, of course, if all these environmental benchmarking tools are using LCA, we need to ensure that the right kind of data is going into these LCAs so we know what we're actually talking about. So the LCA Technical Advisory Group has been doing a lot of research along the whole supply chain, as you can see here on the slide, and they are also continuing to do more work in this space. Yeah, so the first task the LCA Technical Advisory Group looked at was that a lot of LCAs that existed up to that stage when they looked at it was that they were using a lot of old data. So for example, for the early stage processing, the scouring stage, the data was 25 years old. And imagine all the environmental legislation that has been put in place over the past 25 years, and all these early stage processors had to update the facilities in order to meet those environmental legislations such as REACH, for example. And for the spinning industry, for example, or also the gum makeup finishing, the LCAs were not using data from these supply chains, but data from other industries, so-called proxy data. So the first step for the wool industry was, of course, to supply actual data from the wool supply chain and work with real-life data and not data based on assumptions. So in other words, the wood industry followed the wise words of Mark Twain: it is wiser to find out than to suppose. And this is a returning theme I will come back to throughout my presentation. The next thing the researchers focused on was another problem in LCA, and that is the sheep and wool itself. They are very complex and yes, many different ways. So, as you know, sheep are multi-purpose animals. They provide not only wool, but also meat, milk, lanolin, and other byproducts. Next, there are over 500 different sheep breeds, ranging from small to large, and they grow all sorts of different qualities of wool. And these sheep live in a wide variety of countries and very different regions, which also, and they are reared in very different ways, so from very intensive farming to very extensive farming. So all of these factors need to be considered in LCA, because the environmental impacts differ if you use wool grown on a sheep meat in the north of Scotland or on a merino wool sheep in Uruguay, for example. And this complexity makes it really complicated to gather the data and also at the same time impossible to make assumptions about wool. And in other words, the environmental impacts of 1 pound of wool do not equal the environmental impacts of another pound of wool. And also one more thing to consider is if sheep produce not only wool but also meat and other byproducts, then the environmental burdens need to be split up between the different products. So the CO2 emissions or the methane emissions need to be divided up between the products. Or would you want your wool suit to carry all the environmental burdens while your lamb shops tonight, they get a free pass?
No.
But then, how do you divide up these impacts? And there are these so-called allocation methods. They are also defined by the ISO standard. They are also ranked in which method is the preferred method. So for example, the least preferred method is the economic allocation method. But that is often the easiest because economic data is readily available. But just, you know, when you're sourcing wool, that wool products, wool prices can vary quite a bit. And the same is also for meat. So the impacts with economic allocation are not that accurate. And the LCA Technical Advisory Group actually now identified that protein requirement is the best allocation method, and that looks at how much protein is needed to produce wool or produce meat, etc. And in a scientific research study, found that a lot of the LCAs in the past, actually each of them used a different allocation method. And depending on which method was used, and also which fiber type was used, a different result came out. So we put together this slide where you have different environmental impact assessment measures, and then also different types of wool, from very fine wool to very coarse wool. And you see, depending on which method you use and what type of wool, you get a different result. And in order to get more clarity and to avoid this variety of results, the wool industry has defined guidelines on what are the preferred allocation methods and also what other research methods should be applied in order to create wool LCAs. And if you're interested in these guidelines, they are available for free on the adwgo.org website. So all of this work was done, new data was put into also the Higg index, for example, but the ratings are still negative for wool. So I will want to now focus on what actually we need to look at in order to get the true environmental assessment of wool. So as I said, there have been a lot of LCAs done in the past. But when we looked at them closer, the LCAs actually only considered the beginning of the supply chain. So they looked at on-farm and up to the processing stage to fabric. So from fiber to fabric. And the same is also for environmental benchmarking tools, such as the Higg index or made by. They only life cycle actually looks more like this. But we all agreed earlier that life cycle assessment means from cradle to grave, or ideally from cradle to cradle. And in order for us to assess the true environmental impact of our fiber textiles, we need to include also the use phase and the disposal phase. And of course, there are also some LCAs out there that are taking the use and the disposal phase into account. But here we come again to a problem we discussed earlier, that a lot of the data used on the use phase and the disposal phase are actually based on assumptions. So for example, for the use phase, it is assumed that a garment was worn once a week, washed once per week, then would last for 1 year, and then was disposed to landfill. But we can maybe all think about how we use our garments. I'm going to reveal, for me, after 1 wear of my underwear, I do wash them. But I don't wash my coat after 1 wear. And maybe also for your gym clothes that are made of cotton or synthetics, you would probably wash them at a higher temperature, maybe 40 or 60 degrees. But then your wool ski underwear or your merino hiking shirt, you probably look at the label and it says wash at 30 degrees on a cool wool cycle. So how we use our garments is different depending on the fiber content. And so for the next couple of slides, I want to look at how we take care of our clothes, how long we use them, and what do we do when we no longer need them. And there's been a recent study only published in July of this year, and they looked at the use phase, and the reference to this research is also in the handout that is on each table on the back of these, where you have the images on the back, there's a reference list. So this publication is also there for you if you're interested. I quite enjoyed it, but maybe you do. So yeah, these researchers also found that when it comes to the use and the disposal phase of our garments, we treat them differently depending on the fibers they contain. So the study looked at different aspects of maintenance, for example, odor, stains, the cleaning methods we used, washing temperatures, dyeing temperatures, and also the shedding of microfibers. So I'm not going to have time to go into all of them, but a few I want to look at with you. So the studies show that the wool gets worn more times before it gets washed. So for a wool t-shirt, it's 3 times before it gets washed, and for a wool sweater, it's even 10 times. And compared to a cotton t-shirt, it would be 1.5 wears, and for a cotton sweater, 5 wears on average. So, and also the fiber content influences, how I said earlier, also the washing temperature. So wool gets washed on a cool wool cycle, but we tend to wash other fibers on a higher temperature. And the lifespan of garments, that was also looked at. So a wool t-shirt would last 6 years typically, and a similar cotton t-shirt would be 3.8 years. So the research shows that wool is worn more before it is washed, it is washed less often, and it has a longer lifespan. And this brings us to the next issue in LCA, is how do we actually calculate and define the lifespan of a garment? How long do we expect a garment to last, and how long will it actually last? And then, again, we tend to rely on assumptions. So one of the best ways that is assumed to measure how long clothes will last is to look at physical strength, resistance to abrasion or pilling, and color fastness. And these are all tests that can easily be done in a test lab. But when we look at wool, and we would actually do a physical strength like this on that picture on your far right, where you pull apart a fabric, then wool would actually tear apart more easily than a synthetic fabric. So in a test lab, we would measure that wool would not last very long. But if we look at reality, there There has been a Norwegian closet survey, and participants were asked what their oldest garments was still in use, and the average age of a garment was 15.8 years. And some of the garments they found were even over 30 years old. And most of these old garments were actually made out of wool. They were either wool sweaters, Norwegian national costumes, or a wool suit. And actually, I brought today one more example that you also see on the slides. So this is my father. He'll be 82 years old in November. And my mom says that he already owned the sweater when they met, and they got married in 1972. And my father says that he bought it in the end of the 60s. So this sweater is around 50 years old. And at some point, I snatched it from him and started wearing it myself. But yeah, this is just another example that we don't just use our garments for 1 year, and they can actually last quite long. And let's be honest, do we only get rid of our garments when they fall apart? And actually, most of the times, as you would know, we get rid of our clothes when they don't fit anymore, or we actually just don't like them anymore. And so the reasons for getting rid of our clothes are very much linked to social, emotional, and aesthetic factors. And only 18% of the reasons why we get rid of our clothes are connected to durability. So for me, that's not a very convincing point to use durability testing and test labs for our LCAs. And then another assumption that's being made is how we get rid of our clothes. And the assumption is that we put all our garments to landfill. But in reality, we very often extend the lifespan of our garments through reuse and a second life. We recycle, resell, or donate. And the numbers support this as well. 50% of wool and wool blend garments actually get donated to charity, or handed down to family members and friends, or are sold. And the numbers are quite similar also for other textile fibers. So clothes not always go directly to landfill. And many of you may know that actually wool lends itself quite well for recycling. And research found out that 5% of all recycled fibers content is actually wool. And I know this looks like a very small number, but we had it in yesterday's session that the percentage of wool, or the share of wool in the whole fiber market, is actually 1%. I was told 1.2 is already too optimistic. It's actually gone further down. So then having a recycling rate of 5% is actually quite extraordinary. And last but not least, wool can also biodegrade in landfill as well as in water. And here you see His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, burying a wool sweater along with a polyester sweater in his backyard in Clarence House a couple of years ago. And after a few months, those sweaters were digged out of the ground. And you see that the wool sweater on top started to biodegrade, while the polyester sweater can easily be maybe be returned to the retailer and was functioning very well. So this is of course also a very important factor on the whole microplastics issue, which we had another session already, which was very interesting. But also to consider this, so far microplastics are not at all included in LCA research and are not included in the sustainability index that he can make by. So now we have seen in great detail that how we take care of our clothes is different depending on the fiber. And this means that how we use our clothes has a different environmental impact. And if we were to include all this real-life data from the use and the disposal phase into our LCA, the results for certain textile fibers would actually change. And here you have a calculation including the whole life cycle and assuming that the garment would be washed 52 times before it was discarded. And the use phase, as you can see here, actually has a big, or biggest environmental impact of many of the fibers. But remember that the Higg index and Knight Y actually only include the fiber and the processing stage, so they do not include the use and disposal phase. And another analysis, so if we look at the greenhouse gas impacts and the, depending how long we assume or how long we know that we use the garment, so if we assume that the garment is only used for 1 year, or if we're actually using it for the average 5.2 years, then the high emissions that we have in the beginning of the supply chain on farm actually become relative the longer we use and wear the garment. And maybe to express that in a little bit of a different way, we go to a different subject. So if you look at a plastic cup and a ceramic cup, both can carry your coffee, and so they provide the same service, but one of them is made to last, and so not surprisingly, actually needs more resources to manufacture, while the other one regenerates more waste. So wool would be like the ceramic cup. It takes more to make, but it has a higher value and arguably a nice experience, and you would be using it many, many more times. While fast fashion, for example, would be more like the plastic cup and creating more disposal garbage. So in conclusion of my talk today, what should we take away? And there are three things I would like to summarize. So first of all, we need to look at the whole LCA if we want to understand the environmental impact of our textile garments. If we are only looking at the beginning of the supply chain and not include the use and the disposal phase, we are not doing our planet any favors. Second, when we put together our LCAs, it is dangerous to include assumptions in our data. We need to include real-life data and to truly reflect our environmental impacts. And I will end my talk with a quote from one of my favorite wool researchers. Her name is Ingun Rimsdijk-Klepp. Check out her research, it's really cool. And she says, we need to know where we want to go and not only where we don't want to be. So what she means by this is, we need to ask ourselves some really hard questions. If we are just looking to find support for our current business models of fast fashion, low quality, and cheap prices, then we just continue to measure things in an incomplete way based on assumptions. Or do we want to find the truth of a real environmental impact of our clothes? Then we need to take the use and the disposal phase into account. And the wool industry is prepared to face reality. We are making a lot of research, so we don't base everything on assumptions. And we're engaging with organizations such as the Sustainable Apparel Coalition.